Please welcome John Gruber.
I am John Gruber. I write Daring Fireball. I prepared this entire talk with the idea that most of you probably have at least heard of Daring Fireball. Can I get a show of hands? How many people here are familiar with Daring Fireball? Okay. I created another thing you might have heard of. I created Markdown in 2004. How many Markdown users here? All right. Seems like you're my people. One more. Show of hands. iPhone. Android. All right. All right. Good mix. If you're not familiar with Daring Fireball, that is okay. There is no assumed familiarity necessary to enjoy my talk. This is what it looks like. This is my website. That's from like earlier this week. It is 12 years. It is almost unimaginable that the website looks like this now, given what it started like back in 2002. Here's a screenshot of my original design then. Which I thought would get a laugh, but I actually think this looks terrible. I think that that original logo, I don't know what I was doing with the letter spacing up there, but to me, the words Daring Fireball, they look like teeth that are ready to fall out. It looks terrible. I'm gonna go back. Yeah, much better. What do I write about? I write about design, I write about technology, sometimes I try to be a little funny, sometimes I dip my toes in politics, but what I write about most, what I probably write about best, and certainly what I'm best known for, is I write about Apple. And it has been an extraordinarily interesting 12 years to be writing about Apple Computer Incorporated. They're not even called that anymore, now they're just Apple Incorporated, they're a watch company. But it's really, I mean, and I did not start a site to write about Apple in 2002 thinking that in 10 years they would be what they became. I wrote about it because I was obsessed by them and I was fascinated by them. And maybe the things that interested me and fascinated me about them are what led to their success. But I certainly had no premonition that it was going to become what it is. Just to put it into context a little bit. This is Apple's annual profit in billions of dollars. I picked these 2 years. 2002 is when I started writing Daring Fireball. 2006 is when I started calling it my full-time job. $65 million in profit in 2002. $2 billion in profit in 2006. What happened in between there? Well, it's because I started writing about Apple. no. Right around here is when they came out with the original iPod. And it didn't do much at first. I don't even know, people don't remember this, but when the original iPod came out in 2001, it was a $400 Mac-only, FireWire-only MP3 player. And for us who had Macs and like listening to music, it was amazing. And it was just like the entire Mac, it was like nobody else really even knew what it was or where to buy one or what it could be. So let's add one more year. Now, this is not going to be in any kind of Edward Tufte-approved scale, because there's more years between 2006 and 2013 and 2002 to 2006. But it's just last year, right? So there's 2006 compared to when I started, right? Now look at 2006. It's nothing, right? I did a little back-of-the-math calculation. It is probable, not just possible, but probable that Apple made more profit over this weekend selling the iPhone 6 than they made in all of 2006 calendar year's profit. If they, you know, there's estimates that they might have sold 12 million iPhones over this weekend. You multiply it out by average selling price and take a guess as to their profit margin, they might have made $2 or $3 billion in a weekend. So things are very different now than they were then. Writing about Apple. What else is new since 2002? Well, the landscape of the independent web. When I got started in 2002, I had this sinking feeling in my heart that I was just way too late to the game, because I had all these blogs that I loved and that I read every day. And I just kept thinking to myself, I could do that. I could do that. I would like to do that. I would be good at that. And then like a year or two goes by, and I thought, I'm too late. Sites that inspired me tremendously. Our own Andy Bayo, his waxy.org came out a couple of months before mine, instantly became a daily read. Deuce.com by the amazing Heather Armstrong. She started writing in 2001. Seriously, one of the best writers I've ever met, and has done the whole thing and made a whole career for herself at her own website. Jeffrey Zeldman, his daily report at Zeldman.com started in 2000. Let's pour one out for Textism, Dean Allen's Textism, Gone But Not Forgotten. Huge influence on what I do at Daring Fireball, probably more than any other single website that came before. And I can't sit here and list the inspirations for my work at Daring Fireball without mentioning my good friend Jason Kotke, whose eponymous blog, Kotke.org, started in 1978. That was movable type 0.9. So when I got started doing it, when I started writing Daring Fireball in 2002, it wasn't too late. It's never too late. You could look at that graph a couple times back, and somebody who wanted to start writing about Apple in 2006 could have looked at that chart and thought, oh, it was too late. I should have got started when Gruber got started in 2002. It's never too late, because look at what happened after that. It was a great time to be writing on the web, though, and there was such a great difference between the independent web and the commercial web. It was night and day. There was a chasm in between them. Commercial sites were like where you would go to read articles and news and information about what's going on in technology or whatever you're interested in, primarily come from big corporate-backed sites with a history in print publications, and then they port it over, and then they pay for a really shitty CMS, and they pay a lot of money for it, so they're gonna stick with it. And they were ugly, really ugly sites. And if you went to view source and looked at the code, it was horrendous source code, and it was big, and it was bloated. And people still kinda had slow internet connections. And so things like extra superfluous markup in your website would really hinder the experience of using it, because it would take longer for pages to load. And then you would go to the sites like those that I just mentioned, and thousands of others, made by individuals writing under their own name on their own site. And the sites were clear, and the layouts were simple, and the source code was really, really concise and well-written, and they loaded fast. And so we had this opportunity that was unique, to my mind, in all of media history, where we, the guys like me, who just sitting around in a t-shirt in an office in his apartment, were delivering not just higher quality work, because writing is writing, and you know, you can't say that you're a better writer because you're independent or you work for a publication, but the production quality of the actual finished product, what got sent out to the people surfing the web, was actually significantly higher quality. It was nicer to read Kotke.org than it was to read CNET. It was nicer to read Deuce.com, way more stylish than to read CNN or something like that. It was an amazing opportunity. Go back another 10 years to say 1992, and the world was such a different place. So I was a Mac nut back then. I was in college in 1992, just as obsessed by Apple as I am today. But there was no, well, there was an internet, but there was no web, and there was nobody publishing stuff. It was almost impossible to get weekly news. There was a publication called Mac Week. Anybody remember Mac Week? So for those who don't know, Mac Week was called a trade paper, I forget what they called it. But it wasn't a magazine, but it was printed on real nice glossy paper, but it was like about the size of like the Daily News, you know, it was like a tabloid type thing. And it came out, obviously, once a week. I loved Mac Week, and Mac Week had all the news of new versions of software that was coming out, and they had rumors. They had a rumor columnist on the back page who would tell you all the stuff, you know, that there's now a whole industry about, speculation about new Apple products. You could not buy it. There was no way that you could just call up and say, I would like to subscribe to Mac Week because I'm a Mac nut. couldn't do it. They had this crazy business model where it was all about the demographics of their audience that they were selling to the advertisers. And so the only way you could get Mac Week was to fill out, like, it was like, seriously, like, it wasn't like a card. It was like a job application. You had to, and they, what they wanted were like Mac administrators, people who worked at Mac software companies. You had to be in the industry. I filled that thing out like 3 or 4 times under false pretenses. Trying to get MacWeek. And I had a friend in college who did it. He did the same thing, and he got it. And he was getting MacWeek. And if you did it, you didn't have to pay a damn thing. It just showed up. And I was so mad. I'd say I was a programmer. I'd say I was a system administrator. I think what gave me up was that the address was always a dorm room. But that's a really different world. There was no, we were information starved. And if someone who had an interest like me wanted to do it on his own, how could I compete with MacWeek? How could one person on his own even vaguely compete with it? There were things like newsletters, there were Mac user groups, and they printed up newsletters. But you're just printing stuff on 8.5 by 11 paper and photocopying it and stapling it. And how many of those can you actually send out? You can't compete with something like Macworld Magazine that has a circulation of X 100,000 subscribers. You can't. It's impossible for one person to do it. The web made that possible, and it was incredibly, incredibly exciting. So here's a great quote from Samuel Johnson. No man but a blockhead ever wrote except for money. The independent web kind of turned that on its head too, because most of us were doing it just because we loved it. And even if we didn't make a nickel from it, we wanted to keep going. And for a lot of the people, even to this day, with personal weblogs, they're not doing it for money. They're not doing it with any hope or intention of ever doing it as a full-time job. They're doing it as a creative outlet on the side of their job. And that's another thing that the web made possible that wasn't before. Like, if you were the head of a creative agency, like Jeffrey Zeldman is, there was no way to publish your thoughts on the side while you continue to run a creative agency. You know, there was no venue for it. The web made that sort of thing possible. But that never really applied to me. Right from the get-go, when I started Daring Fireball, my goal, secretly, personally, was always to somehow figure out a way to turn it into my full-time work, because there was no work that I had ever had or ever even considered that engaged me at the level that what I did at Daring Fireball did. So very early on, 2004, I started tinkering with just ideas, throwing stuff up against the wall, see what sticks. I was one of the first sites ever to run Google AdSense. This was in the summer of 2004, I believe. I had one good month where I made a couple $100, and it was because I made an analogy between graphic design and men's hairpiece design. With the gist of the analogy, I'll go on a tangent, was that a newspaper went around and asked people who make men's hair pieces, hey, how come men's hair pieces look so bad? And they were like, you know what, they don't have to look bad, but the secret is, if you're bald, just make it look like you're a little less bald. If you're a little bit less bald, just make it look like you're a little less bald. But all of it's very expensive, and when you tell the client, ooh, that's gonna be expensive, they say, hey, if I'm paying a lot of money, I want a lot of fucking hair. That's what graphic design is like as a freelancer, am I right? Right? It's a pretty good analogy. You give them the price and they're like, well, I want a lot of fucking design. Don't give me this minimalist shit. Well, I used that analogy in an article and I got AdSense ads for men's hair replacement systems. And AdSense was brand new. It was like a new crazy thing, and people wanted me to be successful. So people were clicking the ads. And so I had like this one month where I made like, I don't know, $1,100 or something. I was like, woo, I'm making money. And then like the next month I made like $37. And the ads were ugly, so I got rid of them. I tried selling my own sponsorships, didn't really take off. One thing that really hit, we didn't even have the word crowdsourcing yet, but my secret goal all along wasn't really advertising, it was to be effectively crowdsourced. Go right to the audience, my regular readers, get my 1,000 true fans, to use Kevin Kelly's term, to support me directly. And so I started selling t-shirts for $29, and I sold memberships for $19. And if you bought a t-shirt, you got a free 1-year membership. Much like with crowdsourcing and Kickstarter and the lessons that we've learned since, I just had a hunch early on that while maybe the main reason they might send me some money is they want me to succeed and they want to see the site thrive and they want to see me apply more time to it, but let me help them part with the money by giving them something in return. A t-shirt, right? Just give them a t-shirt. No, the t-shirt did not cost $29 to print, but it makes people feel better. Hey, I got a cool t-shirt. It's got the logo of my favorite site on it. And I helped him, you know, succeed. What could I do, though, for the people who didn't want a t-shirt, who just bought a membership? And at the time, I had an RSS feed that was excerpt only. You know, it just had the article title and a brief synopsis of it, and then if you wanted to read the whole thing, you'd have to click it, which would take you back to my website, and you'd read it there. In other words, the shitty kind of RSS feed. I did that because it was early days, and it just felt crazy to put the full content of my site in the RSS feed and just give it away. And eventually, my friend Jim Kudal of Kudal Partners started a little independent ad network called The Deck. I'm in The Deck to this day. I still have The Deck ads on my site. Andy does too, so does Jason Kotke, a lot of the people I mentioned. And the deck ads, though, this is the way that they work. They're very simple, very unobtrusive. There's no cookies that are being set, no personal information, nothing like that. They don't work in RSS feeds. It's a web thing. So I thought, hey, you know, I mean, I don't get paid per view on the website, and I'll get back to that in a second. Well, a couple minutes, probably. I'll get back to that. But that's the only place where I had ads. And I thought, I can't just put the feed out there for free. So I thought, hey, I know what I'll do. People definitely want the full content in the feed. That'll be a bonus for the members. And I'm a programmer to some degree, so I could gin it up myself. And my philosophy in programming is to be as lazy as possible. So I came up with the simplest possible solution I could, which was you sign up for a t-shirt or a membership. My server gets the ping from PayPal and creates a new little 10-character random string, puts it in a database, sets an expiration date 1 year later, saves your email address, and then sends you an email that says something like, hey, Bill, thanks for signing up as a member for Daring Fireball. As a benefit, you get access to the full content RSS feed at this URL, daringfireball.net/members/feed, and then the 10 random characters. This URL is yours personally for your personal use. Please don't share it. If you know anybody else who might be interested in the full content feed, please encourage them to become a member too. Thanks so much, John Gruber. And it worked great for a couple of years. There was almost no problem. You know, if one person wanted to share it with a couple of friends, who cares? You know, it's not like any kind of quote-unquote piracy. And I'll stretch the limits of the word piracy to say sharing an RSS feed URL. It really wasn't a problem. I did have some code on the back end that was tracking how many times each feed was being hit, and you know, none of them seemed out of the ordinary. And then things changed, though, because in the early days, everybody, at least at Daring Fireball, who was reading RSS feeds, was doing it on their Mac. Most of them using NetNewsWire by my now colleague at another venture, Brent Simmons. But there were other great Mac news readers. They ran locally, you subscribed to feeds, you could put your own little personal Daring Fireball feed in there, and it all just worked. But circa 2006 or so, what changed is that people started using online aggregators like Blog Lines and a couple of others. And those things were all set up in a way that just assumed that if you gave it a URL, the URL was public, and they wanted to encourage people to find other feeds, so they remembered all the feeds people used. And then when you'd go there and you'd search Blog Lines for Daring Fireball, it was confusing, because instead of like one feed showing up, there'd be like 70 feeds or 113 feeds, and they'd sort them by popularity. And you'd click through them and see what are they like, and you'd see the one that they were supposed to see, which was free, which just had the excerpts, and they'd be like, eh. And then they'd see the one that had all the articles, and they'd be, oh yeah, that one, and then they would subscribe to that one. Nobody had done anything wrong. The Daring Fireball members who had posted those URLs into Blog Lines were just trying to use Blog Lines, and Blog Lines made a sane assumption that the URLs people were subscribing to that weren't password protected were public feeds. And the people who just randomly discovered it had every reason to assume they were supposed to discover it, and that I was just really, really bad, maybe crazy at designing URLs. I don't know, usually they end in .xml. This one ends in some kind of hexadecimal code. The other thing I did in 2006 was I decided to go full-time on Daring Fireball. And my goal from like 2004 to 2006 was to sort of build up the revenue that was coming in from Daring Fireball as steadily as I could and get it up to the point where it was roughly equivalent to my salary at the full-time design job that I had. And then when it got there, it would go from being a nice side project, I would just step over and I'd be like, okay, now I do this and forget about the job. And now my family still has the same level of income that we did before I quit the job. And it was a really nice hobby. I think it was making a lot more money than most people with a personal blog in 2006 had, but it was nowhere near my full-time salary. And I didn't know what to do. And I could see that it wasn't getting there fast. And I came up with a theory that it was only ever gonna work after I started putting full-time effort into the site. That I had to put the full-time effort in first for months to make it more popular. And then when it got more popular, it would start making more money, and then that would start the circle where the revenue would get up to the point where I would do it. By far and away, the scariest thing I ever did in my career was doing that. And it's not because it was irrevocable, because clearly if I did it, if I had tried it and it had fallen short, I could have always just gone and gotten another job. And if anything, the more notoriety Daring Fireball had, the easier it would be, or even today, to get a day job somewhere. I mean, I could probably just hand in a resume that says, I'm John Gruber, and get a job someplace. No, it was scary because I did it publicly, because I didn't just silently quit my job. I did it and announced on the site, hey, I'm going full time. I think it's only gonna work if I do this. I don't know if it is. Any of you out there who've been sitting on the fence for a year or two thinking, maybe I should become a member, maybe I should buy a t-shirt, if you've been sitting on the fence for a while, this is the time to do it. And the response was overwhelming. It was by far and away the most t-shirts I had ever sold, maybe even to this day. Lots and lots of new memberships. And you know, somewhere, I don't know, $30,000, $40,000 in profit when all was said and done. And that was the nest egg with which I launched Daring Fireball as a full-time effort. And as the year went on, month to month, especially the first few months when I was getting started, we were just eating into that savings and eating in and eating in and eating in. But then it, you know, month by month, it was like kind of creeping up. And then by the end of 2006 or so, it was maybe like break even. It was like our monthly bills and our monthly revenue were close enough that if you squinted, they looked all right. And then it kind of stuck there. That's just where it stuck. And that was kind of a weird place to be, and I had never really anticipated that. I thought only in binary terms when I first started it, and I thought, this is either gonna crash and burn, and like 3 months later, I'm gonna be like, guess what, I have a new full-time job. Or it's gonna be a rousing success, and I'm never gonna have to have a real job again in the rest of my life. I did not anticipate the sort of month-to-month struggle of, boy, I hope we can pay all our bills this month. And then a weird thing happened in 2007. There's one company whose decision, a product decision that they made, more or less set the future for Daring Fireball as a financial operation, at least. And I think that the company that this is super, super, well, I think funny, but at the very least, it's ironic, because it's Google. And it's funny slash ironic because today in 2014, I'm probably well known as if not a critic, at least a skeptic of Google and their privacy. And as a design critic, I'm not a fan of their device ecosystem as it compares to iOS. But I do like Google overall. I mean, I may be harsh on them and I may criticize them at times, but I do like them. But what it was in particular that saved Daring Fireball was this, and that is because Google Reader did not grasp password-authenticated feeds. But I had to switch to password-authenticated feeds from the old system of just putting the little crazy URL at the end because, like I said, thousands and thousands of people were using it who weren't supposed to, and I thought it was discouraging people from becoming members. So I switched to password authenticated feeds, and then I started getting email every day from very nice readers, always polite. I don't think I ever got a single angry letter about this. Always nice. Hey, John, big fan. Been reading your site since the beginning. Became a member 2 years ago, became a member 3 years ago, 1 year ago, whatever. Started using Google Reader. How do I get your feed to work in Google Reader? And it was always posed that way. How do I get it to work? Because of course it had to work somehow in Google Reader because Google Reader isn't crazy popular. And that's what you do is you read your feeds. And I would write back. Well, ends up Google Reader doesn't support password authenticated feeds yet. Hopefully they will soon. And when they do, I will write about it at Daring Fireball, let everybody know how to set it up. And the months went on, and it just became worse and worse. And I think when you keep getting the same email every day from more and more people, you just step back and you think, well, what am I going to do about this? So I stepped back, and I thought about it not from my perspective, but from Google's perspective. And as soon as I did that, it just snapped. I mean, I should have known it instantly. Google was never, ever in a million years going to support password authenticated feeds in Google Reader. Because think about it from Google's perspective. I have a feed. I have 2,000 subscribers who use Google Reader who read the feed. Google hits that feed once. Oh, there's a new article. Grabs it. Then all 2,000 people who use Google Reader get it from Google. One hit, all 2,000 people get it. Then if my feed gets more popular, and now I have 10,000 people reading it in Google Reader, they still hit the feed once. I don't know, every 5 minutes, 10 minutes, whatever Google Reader's refresh cycle is. If there's something new, they pull it down, then they give it to everybody. With password authenticated feeds, think about it, they would have to check once for every user. So if you have 2,000 users, they would have to check that same feed 2,000 times. They'd have to use HTTPS. They'd have to do the password. Google doesn't operate at a scale like that, 1-to-1, 1-to-1. Google does like 1-to-10,000, 1-to-100,000. Never was going to happen. So I had this decision. What am I going to do? I could stick to my guns and my dream. And again, I'd been for 3 years working primarily under the assumption that if I ever made Daring Fireball really work, it would be direct reader crowdsourcing. And a big part of that for me was the RSS feed. Literally, thousands of people who signed up for it just to read my feed. But there's so many other people that wanted to use Google Reader, and I couldn't do it. And so I thought, you know what? Never err. It always seems like the best idea to err on the side of making the reader, the user, the customer, whatever you want to call them, make them happy. And I thought the only way I can do that is to just make the full content feed free and figure out a way to make money on it after that. So I made the feed free. And I thought, there, everybody gets the full content for free. Now, how can I make money on this? And the first thing that comes to mind is, well, you put an ad on every entry. Well, that's horrible. And there were companies like FeedBurner you could sign up with that would inject ads into your thing. And I did the math based on like how many subscribers I had. And I thought, hey, I've got all these subscribers. This is great. I've got like tens of thousands of people subscribed to my RSS feed. And it was like I could expect like $7 a day from FeedBurner or something like that. And it's like, well, that's worthless. So I thought maybe I can sell the sponsorships myself. What would be the best way to sell a sponsorship in an RSS feed? And I thought, well, let's take it easy. Let's make it simple. One spot a week, whoever buys the sponsorship gets 100 words. I'll put it in the feed on Monday. It'll be marked as a sponsored thing, so nobody's fooled that it's an entry by me. And then at the end of the week, I'll thank that sponsor on the homepage of Daring Fireball. I called my friend Paul Kafasis, who runs Mac software company, Rogue Amoeba. Ran the idea by him, and he said, that sounds great, I'll be in. Because I wanted to have a couple lined up before I announced it. And he said, what are you thinking? I said, $500? And he goes, sure. Now, Paul's a notorious cheapskate. So I instantly knew that I had underpriced it. I forget who I sold the second one to, but it was 15 minutes later, and I sold that one for $750. And I thought, okay, I'm on to something. Quickly, and as the schedule filled up, I just raised the price steadily over the years, and it's now pretty expensive. And in 7 years, 52 weeks a year, I've never had an unsold week. So thanks to Google Reader, I finally found a revenue stream that actually worked, was sustainable, and made everybody happy. Readers liked it because it was inobtrusive, and they liked the sponsors. I only run sponsorships. Over the years, I've had to reject a handful, not too many, but a handful because I didn't think that what they were trying to sell would be of interest to my audience. Sponsors like it. I have an enormous number of sponsors who come back for repeat sponsorships, which to me is the clearest sign that it works. And I like it because it makes money. There is a bad guy in this story. There's a boogeyman, and that boogeyman is CPM. How many people are familiar with CPM? A lot of people, yeah, a lot of scars. CPM is the industry standard. I hate to even call it an industry standard, but it is the way that the web works with advertising. And it really means cost per impression. And it just shows you how stupid the people who came up with it is, because impression starts with an I. CPM is what you get when you let the inmates run the asylum, because CPM wasn't designed by the publishers, it wasn't designed by writers, it wasn't designed by creative people who want to sell sponsorships or advertising on their work. It was designed by the ad agencies, the advertisers, who are desperate and crazy for all the metrics and click data and personal information and cookies that track you across websites. And they don't give two shits about the actual content. CPM just means, how much money do you make per 1,000 impressions? So you buy an ad from me for $7 CPM. I put it on my site. Next 1,000 page views the ad goes out on, you give me $7, and that's it. The problem with CPM, well, there's a lot of problems with it, but it doesn't have any, there's no way to value one form of content over another. So for example, when I write a long article, sometimes they'll run 2,000-3,000 words. And I put them on one page, and it just scrolls down, because I trust that people can scroll web pages. And to me, that's a very convenient way to read something long. People might say, oh, I wasn't expecting a long article from John today. I'll save it for later, and then they'll read it when they have time. And they might spend 30 minutes or 45 minutes of intense concentration reading my work, thinking about it. One impression. Somebody else uploads an animated GIF of a kitten riding a skateboard. You load it, you watch the animation. 5 seconds later, you close the tab. One impression. They're valued the same. I've spent a week writing this article. Some asshole spent 30 seconds making an animated GIF of a kitten on a skateboard, and it's all just one impression. And it just leads to this bottom of the barrel chase where everybody is just throwing up stuff to get impressions, 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 and clicks, and clicks, and clicks. And even if you do, if you are lucky enough to write somewhere that will support you to write a 2,000 word piece, they're gonna break it up into multiple pages, and you get 600 words in, and it says, click here for the next page, which my dyslexia always confuses, and it says, close this tab and go to another site. Anybody else have that? It's profoundly disrespectful. CPM advertising is profoundly disrespectful to the reader who gets clickbait headlines, pagination, you have to click this, click that, keep going. And it's disrespectful to the creative people who make it, to the writers. Because everybody knows, anybody who's ever looked at the analytics for any kind of site that paginates knows that there is a severe drop-off after the first page, and another severe drop-off after the second page. Because that thing I said where people get there and they're like, I'll just close the cab and go somewhere else. That's not a joke. That's what people really do. And so if you just let it scroll, people would keep reading. And instead, you make them click, and they know they have to wait a couple seconds, and couple seconds is a long time, so they close. Disrespectful. And the worst part about it, of everything, is it hasn't really worked. The traditional publishing industry is no better off today than they were when they started this bullshit. Right? I mean, we keep hearing about publications that are in trouble, that are going under, that are doing layoffs. It just doesn't work. So it's a little depressing. I had high hopes after I kind of made it work and I felt like my airplane was up off the ground and stable. I never really had any faith that traditional print publications with websites were ever going to figure it out, because they seemed so hopelessly lost, so institutionally bound to protecting their legacy business at the expense of the web, that I never really thought they would figure it out. But I always had high hopes for web-first publications. Not just one-man shows like me, but ones with a real, you know, 20-person team or a 30-person team, and that they would figure out a way to make something work other than CPM. And instead of figuring out something better than CPM, I feel like what web-only publications, the new ones that are coming out, like BuzzFeed and Vox and others, what they've done is figure out a way to make CPM work. And we've gotten words now like listicle. Like, the fact that that's a real word and it's a real thing that we all see, I find it so utterly depressing, because I don't think I'm a particular idealist, but I really did think, when I got started writing Daring Fireball, and then when I made it work as a business, that the internet was going to be this tremendous forum for serious work, for people who are writers, not people making listicles. Personally, my future is very simple. I remember last year at Cable Sasser's talk where he was like, what am I going to do? How's this going to end up? I know what I'm going to do. I'm going to write Daring Fireball until I fucking die. I really do feel like the luckiest. I may not be the most successful writer on the planet, but I'm certainly the luckiest, because I get to write what I want to write and only what I want to write when I want to write it all day, every day. And it is like my list of things I want to write about for 12 years has continued to grow faster than I can tackle it. What an wonderful, lucky opportunity that I have. I just can't believe that there aren't more people. I thought that when I kind of burst through, and Heather Armstrong at Deuce burst through, and Kotke went full time with his site, I thought that we were pioneers. And maybe not even because we were particularly talented, but because the three of us and others had come from a web development and design background. And in those years, it really was an enormous leg up if you had the technical acumen to set up Apache yourself, to do htaccess. Movable type was a wonderful, wonderful gift to the world. So was WordPress. But just installing something, even like WordPress, was beyond most people's means. But then as the world moved on and we got things like Tumblr and Squarespace and other things where people whose interests were totally non-technical could just as easily set up a site of their own and write about stuff, I just thought that's the future, is one writer per site with their own name, building their own brand, and, you know, let 1,000 flowers bloom in every industry. And it just hasn't turned out that way. And it really makes me a little bit sad. If there's any hope, and I do want to leave it on an upbeat note, I do think that the crowdsourcing strategy that I started out with is way more possible today than it was then, because I think people have gotten used to it. Kickstarter has certainly helped in a big way. Wouldn't have helped me, because Kickstarter, the nature of Kickstarter is very project-based. There's like a beginning and an end, and you have to ship this thing, and then that's it. It's not really set up for somebody who says, I would like to write this website for the rest of my life. But there are some new things. There's Patreon, how do you pronounce it? You guys know I don't know how to pronounce things. Patreon, which is more or less just the same basic idea. Somebody who's a writer or makes a webcomic or maybe a podcast, any kind of serial thing that's ongoing, if you're a big fan, they can set up a thing at Patreon, and you can become a patron, and you subscribe monthly or yearly or something like that, and give them a recurring revenue stream. And there are some people who are making a living off that, and I think that's great. I do think my sponsorship model is underused. I think there's a lot more sites. There's other people who followed and do it, but I think treating it as a limited resource, saying one a week, don't worry about clicks, don't worry about impressions, don't worry how many pages I serve. There's one sponsor a week, and that's it. That limits things in a way that, to me, not one-to-one, but is roughly more analogous with something like the back page of a magazine, where there is only one back page of a magazine, and it's the only page you can see without opening up, so you can sell it for more money. I think doing something like that to create scarcity is so much better than the CPM model of, let's see how many thousand people we can get to click on 13 celebrity nose jobs that have gone bad. So I have a few takeaways. Know when to be flexible. I think I went too far, did I? Yeah, know when to be stubborn. Yeah, that's where I want to be. So for me, knowing when to be stubborn, CPM, never considered it. Never once considered running CPM ads on Daring Fireball, even if it meant I had to write the thing for free. Selling out. Never once entertained a single offer to sell Daring Fireball to any entity, because I think it would have ruined it. Getting a job writing Daring Fireball for someone else, same thing to me as selling the site. Never considered those things. Know when to be flexible. So this to me is clearly, in hindsight, the only really good business decision I ever made in Daring Fireball was giving up on that membership for the full content RSS feed, which the more I think about it and the more I've rehearsed this talk, never really sounded like that good of a way to make a lot of money. But I was hell-bent on it for 3 years, and then I just let go for Google Reader, which I didn't even use, and tried something new that didn't violate any of those things that I'm insisting upon being stubborn about. Prioritize quality over money. That's my third thing as a takeaway. To bring it back to Apple, I actually think that this actually is an apt description of the way they work, that the first priority of that company is to create products that they're proud of and that they think are top-notch. And then their second priority, and it's definitely a high priority. You don't get $37 billion in profits without valuing money. But it's a second priority, is, okay, now let's sell them at a profit. I've said this before other times I've been public speaking. I think it's such an important lesson, and it's so easily overlooked, that you can say, here's my three priorities, here's my three things that guide my life. It matters what order you put your priorities. Putting quality as one and making money as two leads to tremendously different results than saying, I want to make money first and create high quality products or work or writing or whatever second. And I firmly believe, there's no way to prove it, but in my gut, I do think it's true that there's a little, the surprising part about it is if you do it this way, a lot of times you can make more money than you would if you valued the money first and concentrated on it first. So those are my three points. I was rehearsing this. Know when to be stubborn, know when to be flexible, prioritize quality over money. And I started repeating them over and over and over again in my head, and I realized that this reminded me of something, right? Know when to be stubborn, know when to be flexible, quality over money, right? It's an iPhone, it's a phone, it's a widescreen video iPod, it's an internet communicator, it's a phone, it's an iPod, it's an internet video communicator. Are you getting this, right? You gotta know when to hold them. You gotta know when to fold them. You never count your money when you're sitting at the table. I've spent 45 minutes of your time paraphrasing the great poet, philosopher, king, Kenny Rogers.
You gotta know when to hold 'em. Know when to fold 'em.
Everybody!
Know when to walk away. Know when to run. You can count your money while you're sitting at the table. There'll be time enough for counting when the dealing's done. Everybody, you gotta know when to hold 'em. Know when to fold 'em. Know when to walk away. Know when to run. You never count your money when you're sitting at the table. Time enough for counting when the dealing's done.
Thank you. Thank you, Andy. Thank you to Jonathan Mann.